Look to this day, for it is life, the very life of life. In its brief course lie all the verities and realities of your existence, the bliss of growth, the glory of action, the splendor of achievement are but experiences of time. For yesterday is but a dream, and tomorrow is only a vision, and today, well lived, makes yesterday a dream of happiness, and every tomorrow a vision of hope. Look well, therefore, to this day. It is for the light of truth, the warmth of community, and the fire of commitment do we kindle our chalice flame this day. Come, let us worship together.
Thank you. Thank you. Welcome. Welcome to All Souls Church Unitarian. My name is Shari Gilbert, she, her pronouns. For almost 200 years, we have created an international community where we search for the spiritual together, put our passion for social justice to work, and remind ourselves of our responsibility to and for one another. Our mission here at All Souls is to build what Dr. King called the beloved community. As Unitarian Universalists, we are diverse in so many ways, but united in our belief in the inherent worth and dignity of every person, and in the obligation to express our faith through acts of justice and compassion. We invite you to join us as we seek to create a diverse, justice-seeking, spirit-growing community that is true to the dream of all souls. This month kicks off our 200th anniversary celebration. We'll be learning about some of All Souls' ancestors, both departed and still living, and we'll reflect on the gifts and legacies they left with us. Whether you are with us in person or around the globe online, you are welcome to join us on this journey of the spirit. This is the time in our service when we behold one another, either in person or online. If you're on Zoom, put yourself on gallery view and scroll through and greet the beautiful faces. If you're in the sanctuary, feel free to get up and greet one another, elbow bump or bow or whatever feels safe. Please, let's greet one another.
Good morning, All Souls. I'm Dolores Miller, the Director of Religious Education. The All Souls theme for November is ancestors. So I decided to look it up in the Merriam-Webster Dictionary. It tells me that ancestor means to come before, one from whom an individual is descended. So an ancestor can still be living. We're about to go into our 200th anniversary celebration here in All Souls. So I thought this would be a good time to hear from some of our oldest living ancestors. Enjoy the interviews.
My name is Charlotte Milner, and I'm 15 years old.
My name is Camille Metzler, and I'm about to turn 12 this week. Welcome. I am Cassandra and I'm 6 years old.
My name is Sam. I am 7.
Hi, I'm Joseph and I'm 13 years old.
I'm David and I've been at All Souls for 23 years.
I'm Judith Bauer, and I've been at All Souls for 28 years, 27 as a member.
I'm Meredith Higgins Hargrave, and I've been a member for 60 years.
I'm Nancy Simon, and I'm 91 years old.
What brought you to All Souls?
I was brought here by my parents to attend kindergarten.
My husband and I wanted to celebrate our 20th anniversary by renewing our vows, and someone suggested All Souls. When I was leaving, I stopped by the receptionist to say thank you for her help, and she said, "Why don't you come to All Souls for church?" And I thought, "Well, why not?" And that's the power of the individual invitation.
In Ohio, at age 16, I became a Unitarian. When I moved to Washington, of course I would be at All Souls.
What keeps you here?
This liberal church just keeps me here.
After so many years of trying to find a spiritual home, I found All Souls. I found Unitarian Universalism. And within that, I found a community that was really trying to be that justice-seeking, spirit-growing entity that we talk about every week.
I keep coming back because of wonderful people and staff.
When I first arrived at All Souls, the church never closed until 9 or later in the evening, between 9 and 10 o'clock. It had all kind of activities that helped serve the community and do things in the community. And then the people.
What do you want people to remember about you?
I never really thought about my legacy. I just try to live my life so that I feel like my time spent in this universe, that I will have done something to make the place a better place for somebody.
I hope people remember that I was true to the spirit and faith of Unitarian Universalism.
How do you want to be remembered at All Souls?
I want people to remember that I said yes with love and gratitude.
Remember the wonderful communities of our congregation who care for each other and the world.
Greetings, All Souls. I have a few announcements for the good of the order this morning, starting with the big one, which is again that this Thursday, November 11th, All Souls Church celebrates its 200th birthday. Amazing. All year, our church will celebrate our spirit of lives generations together. 2 centuries of a congregation united in vision and belief and linked across generations. And on our birthday itself, we'll celebrate with candlelight, love, pealing bells, and song. We invite you to gather at the church for a fun for the whole family, appropriately distanced outdoor celebration, dance party, and sing-along. All that in approximately 1 hour. And because it's Veterans Day, we expect that there will be light traffic and plenty of parking. No need to register, but the music will get started around 5 p.m. By 6 p.m., we'll hear a few words of commemoration, a prayer, and we will lift candles to ensure our beloved community can flood our building with a spirit of light. We expect to be finished with this brief celebration by 6:20. Yeah, I get that math didn't really add up to it in about an hour. The first 20 minutes is just like fun dancing. And again this year, we'll be doing our Thanksgiving Day Connect. Are you willing to connect with an All Souls congregant or congregants who are alone this holiday? Would you like someone from All Souls to call or Zoom in with you? This holiday match is open for people of all ages. Ask for what you would encourage, what would encourage you, or consider giving some of your time to congregational care. Contact Reverend Louise Green to either receive or make contact. And this morning, we are pleased to welcome in person our A. Powell Davies intern, Ebony Contreras Peace. Ebony is a student at the... Ebony is a student at the Meadville Lombard Theological School and is studying for a Master's of Arts in Leadership Studies. She's with us for about 20 hours a week until June 2022. Her internship was made possible by funds from the A. Powell Davies Memorial Fund, and part of her directive is to carry on the legacy of justice inspired by Reverend Dr. Davies. I invite Ebony to come say a few words of greeting.
Thank you, Reverend Rob. All Souls Unitarian, the largest UU church in the DMV, the most diverse, the eldest, the mother church. How in the world did I get so lucky? So blessed to be your first A. Powell Davies intern. I'm still amazed and even more grateful, especially to Reverend Kathleen and the Board of Trustees for their support, for faith in me. I'm a lifelong Unitarian Universalist. I was raised and married at the UU Church of Silver Spring. My current home church is Paint Branch in Adelphi, Maryland. Since I entered the All Souls community on October 1st, I've had a chance to better understand A. Powell Davies' legacy and the mission of this church. I've attended staff and committee meetings, the Envisioning Our Future sessions, and much more. Between now and June, I will be learning and exploring worship arts, adult spiritual development, social justice, and more. I am here to honor A. Powell Davies' legacy, to advance what he held dear, social justice, freedom of belief, and All Souls Church. May it be so.
All Souls has a long history as a teaching congregation, and I hope that we will welcome and support Ebony as we have others, and I hope you will join me and the others on the staff in doing that. Thank you. We turn now to our congregational concerns. We start by recognizing the celebration of Diwali this morning, a joyous celebration of happiness and light from Indian culture and tradition, which began on November 4th. Many around the world are bringing in this time of reunion with beautiful altars and lanterns, and extensive feasting with family and friends. So happy Diwali to all who celebrate it. Two of our staff members, unfortunately, are experiencing concerns in their families this week. We send deep condolences to Dolores Miller, our Director of Religious Education for Children and Youth, whose brother-in-law, Buzz, died on Friday morning. He had been in end-stage cancer and died at home with Dolores' sister, Mary. Love to Dolores, Eddie, Mary, and all their family after a year of loss. And we ask for prayers for the mother of our Minister of Congregational Care, Reverend Louise Green. Her mother, Lindsay, was diagnosed with COVID on Wednesday in El Paso. Her daily caregiver, Martha, and her two young children also tested positive and are quarantined. And so we send healing love to Lindsay, to Martha and her family, to Louise, and to all in their immediate and extended families. Chuck Woldridge continues to tend the care of his father, Charlie, in Kentucky with doctors and family. The situation is not improving. We are sending Chuck, his dad, and their family our love and support. Jane Simpson was in the hospital again since last Sunday, but has been discharged to Sunrise Assisted Living for evaluation. Love to her and her son and daughter as they seek to recover and coordinate a lot of complicated care. Catherine Clarenbach is still hospitalized in serious condition in Portland, Oregon. We continue to send love to her and her spouse, Julie. And a word of announcement in this section, the Celebration of Life for Marjorie Myers will be held next Saturday, November 13th at 3 p.m. Please note that this is a time change due to a public event that is closing streets in the morning. Marjorie died on October 29th of end-stage cancer after a full life that impacted so many people here and beyond All Souls. We send ongoing blessings to her three sons and family as they prepare for that service. Please do register for either in-person attendance or Zoom attendance. Links to both are found on the homepage. In the moment of silence that follows, I invite you to name those that you carry on your heart this morning. Great mystery, spirit of life and love, rejoice with us in our celebrations and hold us close as we navigate so much struggle and loss. Fill us with the power and dreams of our ancestors whose perseverance made our very lives possible. May we be enriched by what they got right and also motivated by what they got wrong. They were not perfect, and neither are we. May we learn from them and each other how to live lives filled with compassion and committed to liberation. May love hold us and guide us today and always. Amen.
Thank you. For all those joys and concerns, named and unnamed, we hold in our hearts this day. Today's reading comes from a sermon by Reverend A. Powell Davies, preached from this pulpit on December 30th, 1945, before I was born. This sermon is entitled, From the Future Comes a Cry. Reverend Davies was speaking specifically about the threat of nuclear devastation. But he cast his vision beyond even that, towards what the future calls us to become. The thing that has happened is that human life itself has reached a crisis. The total life of humankind throughout the planet and the life of every individual human being within that larger life. This is a total crisis in human life itself, demanding that we rise to a new level, not only of belief and affirmation, but of performance. All older, easier ways of life are ending, and age is ending not only for the outer world, but for the inner world, the world of motive and conscious of mind and spirit. Four, from the future comes a cry of challenge, a cry of entreaty. It is for the future we must live, to live at all, though it may be a future we ourselves shall never see. There is nothing else to live for, and in the last analysis, there never was. It is what we aim toward that give our lives their meaning and their true requirement has gone out. For the future is molding the present, the word of challenge and requirement has gone out. From the future comes a cry.
Was that the future I just heard calling out there? Oh, thank you, Ebony. Well, I wonder how many of you have watched Henry Louis Gates's show, Finding Our Roots? Yeah, a fair number. You know, although the format is usually the same, actually it is the same, the stories are infinitely varied. And Gates has had so many famous people, Anita Hill, Maya Lin, Regina King, Scarlett Johansson, John Lewis, Maria Hinojosa, Wanda Sykes, the list just goes on and on. But sometimes he's also had lesser known persons as well. But what they all have in common is Gates leading them on a journey through their ancestry. The show has gathered together a masterful staff of genealogical researchers who help Gates find and tell the stories that are at the root of their family trees. Through letters and census records, ship manifests, even oral histories, famous people are often moved to tears by their ancestors' struggles. And what I love about Gates' show is that he reveals that not all ancestors were saints, and not all were sinners, and most of them were a little bit of both. He tells an honest story of a person, of what they did, what was important to them, and in many cases, how they learned to survive, even under the most dire and despicable circumstances. So as you know from our story for all ages, the theme for this month is ancestors, and what a rich one it already is. I loved today's story for all ages because it recognizes that we can have living ancestors too, persons who have paved the way for us to be here today and who are still among us. Now, of course, in the course of 200 years, there are many ancestors in this church, and most of them were not ordained clergy. There are many stories of church members, but I'm counting on you to help me to tell those stories. I am eager to hear more of those stories. But today, I want to look at the ancestral legacy of Reverend Apal Davies and Reverend David Eaton. Not because their professional ministries were more important than the leadership of the laity, but because of where I want to go towards the end of this particular sermon. Just as Henry Louis Gates Jr. made me interested in the stories of people I have never met, I hope the same will be true for you too, whether listening as a longtime member of this congregation or logging on to our Zoom worship for the very first time. You will find meaning in the lives of these two All Souls ancestors. Now, I also have to confess an institutional purpose as well, because this time next year, All Souls will be completely immersed in the search for a new minister or ministry team. And I want to plant some seeds of thought for your reflection as you begin to imagine not the person you want, or the persons you want in the role that I currently hold as senior minister interim, but about the way this role has changed since the Reverends Davies, Eaton, Aldrich, and Hardy's occupied it. So, let's begin on May 3rd, 1944. The Reverend Apal Davies was called to the ministry of All Souls Church. And not long after his arrival, his preaching began to garner attention. By 1946, the Times magazine had this to say about Reverend Davies, quote, "In Washington, D.C., where many talk but few listen, spare, sharp-profiled Reverend Apal Davies, 44, is a man to be heard. Every Sunday, his congregation overflows from the church auditorium into adjacent halls and recreation rooms. Reason, his 35-minute sermons are protein-rich with wit, wisdom, sincerity, and invective. His preaching has made Welsh-born Davies one of America's outstanding liberal clergymen," end quote. So, what did Davies think of his growing popularity? He responded in this way. He said, "People come to hear me because they are hungry for a religion that makes sense, that does no violence to the spirit. I say as simply as I can what I have to say, and that is why people listen. I call for courage rather than give a promise of solace." And he insisted that, quote, "religion is not something separate and apart from ordinary life. It is life, life of every kind viewed from the standpoint of meaning and purpose, life lived in the fuller awareness of its human quality and spiritual significance." So Davies established himself not only as a public theologian, dispensing moral and spiritual guidance from the pulpit of All Souls, but he also understood his role as senior minister to be a public witness, to be one of public witness and action. And he used the power of his DC pulpit to shed light on and to lead the congregation into several important causes and ministries. Now, I know that there are those of you who have been to All Souls for a while now, know many of the more famous stories about A. Powell Davies' ministry, but they bear repeating. One is his sermon on November 25th, 1945, What Can Anyone Do? He describes the desperate shortage of food in post-war Europe and proposed that this church collect a fund to supplement what the government might do. More than 100 tons of canned food were shipped from 16th and Harvard Street. This generated national publicity. And then, of course, there is the famous sermon, it was actually ad hoc remarks, but that Davis preached in 1946 after seeing this photograph in the Washington Post Society pages. It is a cake in the shape of a cloud formed by an atomic bomb. And the caption read, "Atomic bomb cake fashioned of tiny angel food puffs." Yeah. Davies excoriated this in a sermon. He described it, quote, as loathsome. And he said, "Damn to hell, these people of callous conscience, these traitors to humanity who could participate in such a monstrous betrayal of everything for which the brokenhearted of the world are waiting." End quote. Yes, thank you. And in 1947, in his reply to a letter from Japan sermon, that resulted in a large shipment of school supplies for the innocent victims of the nuclear bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Thus, the relationship between the survivors of the Hiroshima bombings and members of All Souls. And we tell that story almost every year. And the beautiful Heiwa Peace Project is a legacy of A. Powell Davies' ministry. He spoke out forcefully, too, against segregation, inviting members of the congregation to join him in refusing to patronize eating places and places of entertainment where blacks were not admitted. It was Davies who insisted that the whites-only Metropolitan Boys Club, who had been meeting at All Souls building since 1937, become an interracial boys club. The board of the Metropolitan Boys Club did not agree with him on that. And rather than integrate, they left. But as a result, Davies and the congregation ensured that an integrated Columbia Heights Boys Club was formed. Radical. His ministry was the time of pillbox hats for ladies and suit jackets for men. This was when church attendance was booming and women's volunteer labor kept the church running, while Reverend Davies was able to build the ministry of All Souls. Those were the days when sermons were quoted and reviewed in the Washington Post, and when a powerful liberal preacher like A. Powell Davies could be broadcast and people would gather around to hear his stirring and inspiring and spiritually grounded sermons. This was an era of a solo white male minister representing the church as both public theologian and prophet. This was the pulpit that A. Powell Davies served for 13 years until he burned himself out prematurely and died at the age of 55. So, when you think about the future minister you wish to attract, do you have in mind the qualities exhibited by A. Powell Davies? Or do you imagine a ministry more like the Reverend David Eaton? Reverend David Eaton accepted the call to be the senior minister of All Souls in June of 1969. It was a little more than a year after the assassination of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and the destruction of huge swaths of 14th Street, just two blocks from the church. It was the year of one small step for a man, one giant leap for mankind. It was the war in Vietnam, it was peace and love in Woodstock, and it was the summer of soul in Harlem. Unemployment, underemployment were high, overcrowding, widespread signs of urban decay were evident, and there sat All Souls at 16th and Harvard. Generally perceived as a white, upper middle class institution, the church found itself in jeopardy. So into this milieu arrive the 36-year-old Reverend David Eaton, the first black minister to be called to serve this institution. Most were excited about that, but not everybody was excited about calling Reverend Eaton. There were concerns about his lack of ministerial experience, the fact that he was a Methodist. But lurking behind the surface of all of those questions was likely the big question that nobody really wanted to voice. Could this African-American pastor lead this mostly white church? In an article about Reverend Eaton's ministry, historian Charles Howe wrote, quote, "Not long after the church year began in September 1969, some hostility towards Eaton became evident, particularly from a group of older members, the Friendly Seniors, the group called itself. The assistant minister, William Gardner, suggested that the hostile elders might have been a better name. Now, I don't know this for a fact, but I suspect Reverend Eaton's ebullient personality likely won the hostile elders over. He was personable. He was approachable. His sermons combined the intellectual rigor that All Souls demanded with a colloquial style that made the congregation feel like they were part of the conversation. It's written that Reverend Eaton would lean over the pulpit and with arms outstretched challenge the congregation with this question, "Am I right or wrong?" I suspect that it was Reverend Eaton's ministry that set the course for the church that you have today. His more conversational style of preaching, his personal stories combined with theological depth, and his love of and use of music to enhance the worship experience, all are part of the legacy left by Reverend Eaton, which we enjoy and appreciate to this day. It was under Eaton's ministry that the Jubilee Singers were formed to add black voices and black music to what was then a largely white, European-centered program. So like Davies, Eaton was not only a great preacher, but offered a prophetic voice in Washington politics. One of Eaton's first sermons, a May 1970 critique of the Nixon-era legislation, would allow police to invade homes without knocking, and this stoked widespread controversy. The sermon, some of you know this already, entitled "Take the Blindfold Off the Lady," the DC crime bill, included this line: "If this legislation is passed, I suggest to you and instruct myself that if at any time persons break into your house unannounced, shoot them." He went on. He said, "In order to understand true morality, one must understand that oppression must be stopped at all cost." Well, some members were aghast. 40 members resigned from the church, but the board stood behind him, and he certainly got the public's attention. By the late 1970s, All Souls had become recognized not only for its social witness, but as a power center for Washington politics. Among its members were Marion Barry, Betty Ann Kane, Hilda Mason, Charlene Jarvis, all members of City Council. And Reverend Eaton built relationships with the DC community. He created an Emmy Award-winning NBC television program, The David Eaton Show. He was appointed chair of the district's Human Relations Commission. In 1976, he was named Washingtonian of the Year and also Citizen of the Year. Yeah, wow. After 1978, he served on the District of Columbia School Board, much of that time as president. Reverend Eaton's accomplishments were diverse, and his commitments to the district were deep, as were many of his personal skills and qualities that he brought to his ministry. And as part of our own 200th celebration, Silver Souls, we'll rededicate the Eaton Room with a newly refurbished room and a display detailing the history of Reverend Eaton's ministry. Reverend Eaton served All Souls from 1969 until his premature death at 59 years of age in 1992. So I can hear some of you thinking, this is all very interesting, but what does it have to do with me, with us, with the church as it exists today? That was then, this is now. But if we've learned something from Issei Barnwell's song Breaths, we are our ancestors' prayers. The dead have a pact with the living. Our ancestors' vision and commitment, our ancestors' strengths and their failings can instruct us on the decisions we're facing today. And perhaps the biggest decision All Souls will be facing in the next year and a half is the selection of your next minister or ministers. And as I said at the beginning of this sermon, the question facing you now, between now and then, is not who do you want in this position that I currently occupy? What do you want from this role in the 21st century? Until you hired me as your interim senior minister, historically the role of senior minister was held by men and understood to be the voice of the congregation in the public sphere. And it makes sense, particularly here in the nation's capital. It models our democratic leadership structure with one president of the United States, not co-presidents. Yet much has changed since the days of Davies, Eaton, Rob Hardy's ministries. A senior minister may still be the voice of the congregation, but we have to ask ourselves, who is listening and why? The primacy of the role of senior solo minister as public theologian and public prophet is clearly changing. We no longer live in a culture that widely prioritizes the voices of public preachers anymore. Our sermons and moral pronouncements, no matter how powerful, are not likely to be written up in the Washington Post, right? The older model of church, with the senior minister at top and associate and assistant ministers on the next level, and then the laity working on the ground level, has been called into question as another manifestation of white supremacy culture. Now, we've heard one suggestion in the current conversations about the future of this position, and that it could be held by two co-equal ministers, partnering in a co-equal relationship with the executive director. And that would certainly be one way of de-emphasizing the notion that the senior minister or ministers are at the top of this ecclesiastical mountain. It's an option, and it's an example of how wide open and creative this conversation can be. But here's another thought to complicate matters. Throughout All Souls history, you've been rightfully proud of your many accomplishments. This legacy is worthy of our reflection and celebration this year. And some of the talk I hear about the future reflects a desire to restore All Souls' standing and reputation in the community as a leader, as a church known for its racial and ethnic diversity, committed to LGBTQAI plus rights, for its commitment to the environment, for having an opportunity and a voice to weigh in on national issues. And that desire is truly understandable and admirable, but here's another truth. Unitarian Universalism is not the only denomination or institution who is leading the charge in these areas. What we are learning is that there are others who are doing this work, some of them doing it better than we are, some who are equally passionate about this work, but more critically affected by the outcomes than many Unitarian Universalists. So, instead of imagining ourselves always as the leaders, we must learn as well to be followers, allies, partners, advocates. And what this may entail is a decentering of the old idea of senior minister. Let me see if I could be more concrete. When I came into the ministry, the general understanding among congregations was that the minister did the ministry and the laity ran the church. The minister didn't have to get involved in all those institutionally time-consuming things that detracted from the ministry, budgets and governance and bylaws and care and feeding of staff. The church would take care of all that stuff, enabling the minister to study, preach, teach, offer prophetic presence. But as more women, Black and brown ministers, gay and queer ministers entered the ministry, a shift began to happen, which I characterize as this. The minister runs the church to enable the people to find and live out their ministry. That's a radical decentering of the role of senior minister as it had been known for at least the last two centuries. Reverend Eaton used to say, "You are all ministers," to which I offer a gentle corrective. I believe you all have a ministry, and it's my job to help equip, support, and sustain you for the work of the world to which you are called to do. As we seek to discern what it means to decenter whiteness from our institutions and to embrace a true shared ministry, we are also called to undertake a radical reimagining of our institutional life. So our ancestors' prayers were prayers for us to live into and continue to realize a future that only they could imagine. So I want to close with words from the two ancestors we cited today. First, from Apal Davies, who experienced the future not as something he dimly saw, but could faintly hear. He said, "From the future comes a cry of challenge, a cry of entreaty. For the future is molding the present. The word of challenge and requirement has gone out. From the future comes a cry." And by way of benediction, I offer you this prayer that the Reverend David Eaton would say before every sermon. He would say, "May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, my Lord and my Redeemer, always." May it be so.
My middle name is Kyle, Sharon Kyle Gilbert, and I have a really strong connection to the name. My dad traced the name Kyle back to William Emmett Kyle, born in 1752 in the Crag of Kyle in Scotland. And my brother's name is Craig, another name that then continued in the family. So his son, Sir Emmett William Kyle II, born in 1784, emigrated to the U.S., and the records show he died in Montgomery County, Virginia. So that's the first, I guess, the family was in the Virginia. My dad, John Kyle Gilbert, followed the Southern tradition of going by his middle name. So Dad Kyle Gilbert was from Churchville, Virginia, a town with a population of 194 and four churches. That's from the 2010 census. I was baptized at St. James United Methodist Church in Churchville. And in the Gilbert family cemetery plot, it seems like every other grave is a Kyle, or a Gilbert, or a Craig, or a William, or a Montgomery, the county. As kids, we visited Bridge House, the Churchville family home where Dad was raised. It was the perfect big old family home. Old furniture, faded wallpaper, one bathroom, a musty smell, a huge wraparound porch, all set on rolling hills with a creek and a field with an old bull. We had to run across the field to Aunt Judy's house, and that, of course, was her middle name, with the fear of that bull breathing down our backs. We made it. Although my dad created the Gilbert family tree the Kyle family tree back to 1752, and I know my ancestors were Scottish, Irish, German, we never thought about who had originally lived on those rolling hills next to the creek. Thanks to a website passed on from my co-worship associate, Justice Tuia, I looked up and now know that Churchville was inhabited by the Manahoke tribe. Archaeological records show evidence of the Manahoke in that area as far back as 950 AD. Without All Souls' recent inclusion of land acknowledgement in our services, I might not ever have considered the original landholders of the Kyle Gilbert lands I knew as a kid. And while my research has just touched the surface of the Manahoke, it was not my anthropology college degrees, but rather All Souls that really got me thinking about those before the Kyle Gilberts in Virginia. Thank you, All Souls. Your ongoing support is essential to keep All Souls thriving in the present and in the future. There's a link on the chat, which will direct you to All Souls online giving, or you can go to the QR code found in the pews directly in front of you to donate to the church's website. Thank you for your generosity.
This is for all the saints, and all of our music today has been chosen because they were either sung or played during the ministries of Reverend Davies and Eaton. For all the saints. Thank you. place honoring our ancestors, remembering all that they were, the gifts that they bequeathed us. May they live our lives. May we live our lives so that one day we leave nothing behind but a legacy of love. Amen. May it be so. Go in peace this day.
Good morning, All Souls. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, great. Thank you all for staying around. I know we're running a little bit late, so I'm going to go ahead and give you the introduction to our two pieces that are still both content-rich and very tied to the history of this church and this community. So the first piece is from Scott Gendel's cantata that was commissioned here in 2013, All Souls. This is the closing movement, which is based on a text by William Ellery Channing. It is also inscribed on the chancel table. I am a living member of the great family of All Souls. I belong to this family. And then to close us out is Dr. Ize Barnwell's Hope, which I hope that you'll feel comfortable to join me.
Thank you.
If we want hope to survive in this world today, and every day, you've got to pray on, pray on. Yeah, that's right.
That's right.
If we want hope to survive in this world today, then every day we've got to pray on.
If we want hope to survive in this world today, then every day we've got to pray on, pray on. If we want hope to survive in this world today, then every day we've got to pray on. If we want hope to survive in this world today, every day we've got to walk on, walk on. If we want hope to survive